With me now in the studio from Brave Bison, I'm joined by Claire Hungate. Claire, good afternoon. Good to see you.
Hi, Andrew. Nice to meet you.
And you, before we talk a bit more about Brave Bison, the business itself, I know you took over as chief executive, was it during the third quarter last year?
It was September 2017.
September last year. Yes. Tell me a bit more about yourself and your previous working experience, where you came from.
So I come from a TV production background, so I suppose I know content very well, the economics of content, the distribution of content. I helped grow a group of production companies called Shed Media. So we were a group of eight production companies producing TV shows like New Tricks, Who Do You Think You Are, First Dates, Don't Tell the Bride, Super Nanny.
Right.
And we sold to Warner Brothers at the end of 2010. We fully earned out in 2014, at which point I stepped up to lead the newly integrated, newly branded vehicle that was snappily titled Warner Brothers TV Production UK. Stayed there until midway through 2017 and then joined Brave Bison.
Because? What did you see in Brave Bison?
I think the TV production market in the UK is very challenged economically. I can't see lots of money coming into the sector anytime soon. The cost of production doesn't come down, so technology hasn't really helped the cost of production reduce in TV production, just because of the kind of legacy of how we produce content and how we think about it in TV. But in digital, it's very different. You know, the way we produce content is much more flexible, it's much more economic. We can reach more people. We're agnostic about platforms. What we're creating is quality content that engages big audiences. And the platforms that we put those on, we're largely agnostic about. So, you know, for me, it's not about TV. It's not about the pipes that the content goes on. It's about the content and how that content can engage an audience.
And what were your thoughts about Brave Bison when you first joined and its performance?
So, you know, I talked in my interim statement about seeing green shoots within the business. You know, I had heard of Brave Bison before I started. I knew the names of the companies that made up Brave Bison. So, you know, it was an amalgamation, a coming together of Rightster, of Base 79, of Viral Spiral. And I suppose I thought, you know, what happened to those companies, because they were all companies that were really at the forefront of what they did, but they slightly lost their way. But I could see within those companies, I could see really, really valuable assets. And when I talk about assets, I'm talking about relationships, contracts, people, knowledge, that we could bring together, that where we could really focus the messaging of the company, focus in on the skills of the company, focus in on where the market was going and what we did really well and where we could win within that market. And I think that's what we've spent, you know, the first number of months doing, is really clarifying that message, you know, clarifying where we can add value for clients and taking that message out to market.
And so the strategy here at Brave Bison, what is the predominant focus for you?
So, you know, we are a social media company. It's important to, you know, get our messaging out there. For us, we're a social media company, a social video company. So for us, social video is video content that by its very nature is shareable, creates a discussion and is there to be shared on social platforms. And we create that content, we distribute that content, and we monetize that content. So we talk about having three pillars of service: strategy, origination, distribution. And I think what's really interesting about Brave Bison is that we can provide all those services, an end-to-end service. So some of our clients, we will provide all of those services. Others of them, we provide, you know, one or two of those services. But you come to Brave Bison, you can get that end-to-end service within one office, one invoice, you know, one team working with you, and all the organic and synergistic benefits that you can get from that.
And of course, you're working with some big names, Shell, Nippon Airlines, just to name two.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we work with P&G, All Nippon Airlines, Johnson & Johnson, Hyundai, Courtyard Marriott. We've done work with Under Armour, with Puma. We work for the PGA Tour.
That's a recent announcement, that one, isn't it?
PGA Tour. So we've been working with PGA Tour for about a year.
Right.
And had just incredible results working with them. And obviously, they're just about to go into their Discovery joint venture in 2019. So, you know, very, very exciting time for the PGA Tour and for a young audience watching golf on
Indeed.
YouTube, actually. Yeah.
And as far as your own content, you've got or did have 18 channels, mm-hmm. now 20 with the addition of two recent channels. Talk
yep.
us through those.
Yep. So we have a huge and very powerful distribution network. So that is the, you know, the third pillar of our service, I suppose. When we make content for brands, which kind of fits within the origination bit of our service, you know, there is no point creating amazing content if no one sees it. So we can help brands amplify their messaging, get that content out to a massive, massive audience through that distribution network that we have. And that's a mixed portfolio of channels across YouTube, across Facebook, across Instagram. Some of those channels are very high viewing viral video content channels, UGC content. Others are much more editorialized channels like Slash Football. And on those channels, our sell there is very much to brands that, you know, we believe the future of social video, of branded content, is that brands want to know and understand the distribution network where they're going to see their content, where the audience, where they're going to reach the audience. So we are creating channels that, you know, in effect are communities, they're brands in their own right, they're the TV channels of the future. So, you know, if the BBC or Channel 4 want to know where their under 30 audience are, they're on social media and they will be on channels like Mother and Perk, which are our two new channels. So Mother and Perk add to our distribution network. We have consistently over the last 6 months been in the top 10 global media publishers according to Tubular Labs. In May we were sitting at number 2 after Time Warner and before Disney. And you know, the nature of the social media algorithms is that we are always going to move up and down that list, so we don't worry too much about moving up and down it. It's just the nature of the algorithms. But Mother is a channel that's very much aimed at a Gen Z millennial audience. It's a shortening of Mother Earth, and it's concerned with sustainable and conscious living. So we know that generation of people are very concerned with the future of their planet, and they want to make a positive impact on it, not a negative impact. And we believe, or we know from research and from our analysis of the market, that they are more likely to buy from brands who they believe share those values and are doing positive things to negate the impact they have on the world. So we know there is a sweet spot between audience and brands, and we know that it's an underserved space. So there are very few other channels, in fact, no other channels, that are celebrating sustainable and conscious living in the way that we will be. There are other channels that are quite doom laden and are talking about seas full of plastic. But for us, we believe that the way to initiate change in people is to inspire them and is to entertain them. So that's what Mother will do.
And the initial focus here on the United Nations Environment Programme?
Exactly. So, you know, the United Nations Environment Programme are doing so much work in this area, but they have difficulty reaching a young audience that we can reach because they don't have the communication channels to be able to do that. They don't talk in the voice that we'll be able to talk in order to reach and engage that audience. So, you know, they're very, very happy to be working with us on some of their initiatives. And the other channel is Perk, P-E-R-K, and again, launching across multiple channels, YouTube, Facebook, Instagram. We'll also be working on Snap and other channels later on, and be creating content on IGTV, which is the new Instagram video platform. And Perk is concerned with work and careers, again, for that Gen Z millennial audience. So, you know, possibly the most entrepreneurial generation yet, coming out, thinking into the workforce, thinking about their career, think about work and careers very differently to the way I did. You know, they have very different values. They're not necessarily looking for a long-term steady career so early in their lives. They look at themselves as brands. They think they can achieve amazing things. You know, that barrier to entry of setting up your own company, for instance, is much lower potentially than it was, but they're not necessarily tooled up in order to do those things they want to achieve. And they don't want to be told how to do those things by corporations. But, you know, we can use a tone of voice, we can use influencers, creators, ambassadors, Perkers. We're going to have a network of individuals around the country and eventually around the world who will speak in a, you know, in a voice that they understand and will become, you know, the inspiration for a future generation. And, you know, eventually we hope to be joining up that future generation of employees with their future employers.
I think you've got a case study of a butcher to kick things off here, haven't you?
Yeah, a butcher who used to work in the city, became a bit disillusioned, retrained to become a butcher. So, you know, this is about both amazing, you know, incredible jobs that people do, but also about everyday jobs that people do, how they got there, what inspired them to get there. People who have a specific, you know, tone of voice, an interesting story, an inspirational story, be they, you know, a plumber, electrician, butcher, be they an entrepreneur who wants to start their own tech company, or be they a fashion designer. You know, it's all equal and interesting to us.
You talk about the big exposure that these channels offer. I mean, in terms of the actual numbers themselves, what are we talking about across the 18 odd 20 channels that you've got in terms of views?
How many people are looking at them? So in May, we have 5.6 billion views on Facebook alone across those 18 channels. So these are huge distribution networks. They're huge.
Well, looking ahead, what's the focus for you? What are you looking to achieve in the second half of this year?
So we have a number of strategic initiatives that we believe that we will that we can achieve by using cash reserves. So you know, we've announced that we're sitting on, you know, slightly north of £4 million still. So those strategic initiatives for us are our APAC office. So we have an office in Singapore, office in London, office in Singapore, and that Singapore office serves the APAC region. So we know that in the APAC region, ad revenue is still increasing, whereas in the rest of the world, it's pretty static, if not decreasing a little bit. Digital penetration is huge in the APAC region, and yet brands aren't as advanced in their thinking about social video as perhaps they are in EMEA or North America. Or actually their use of influencers. That influencer market is still very much on the trajectory, whereas here it may have evened out a little bit or evened off a little bit. So we believe there are huge opportunities for us in APAC to take, you know, the knowledge and experience we have, you know, that really in-depth knowledge we have of how you engage audiences online and where they are, what video content they want to use, you know, just the beats of the content that are so different. Storytelling is so different across those different platforms than it is on other channels. So for us, it's about moving into other territories, potentially in the APAC region. At the moment, we can unlock regional budgets out of Singapore. But we believe that by being in the other regions, in the other countries, we can unlock local budgets. So we're going into Indonesia and also into South Korea, where we think there are real opportunities for us to use that knowledge base that we have. And then it is about investing more in our owned and operated channels. Mother and Perk, we've talked about. You know, the idea of Mother and Perk is that they are part ad revenue, it's part brand revenue for the content we're producing for brands. But we will then, once we've created these communities, really, you know, engaged, passionate communities, we can move them around to different platforms. We can take them to websites where we own 100% of the inventory. E-commerce across social and online is, you know, really growing very, very quickly. People are much more prepared to make purchases on smartphones than they were, you know, a year ago. So, you know, that's a big area of business for us as well. We are investing more in our strategic partnerships, which is those fee-based deals we have with companies like Shell and HP. They're a classic consultancy model. It's fees for services, so we're investing more there. We think that's a real growth area. And in content production, you know, we're working for companies like Sky Q. They're commissioning content from them. You know, we have content, we have conversations with All4 and BBC Three. So, you know, our selling point to those companies is we understand, digital first companies understand audiences on digital, how they consume content, and how to make content that engages them. So, you know, those are our four big strategic initiatives.
We talked a bit about your own background at the start there, but of course, during the first half, Kate Burns came on board as a non-exec.
Yeah, absolutely, very
director.
Excited about that, yeah.
Strong addition to the team?
Very, very strong addition to the team, yeah. You know, she really understands this world. She's been working in it. She knows a lot of people in it. She knows the challenges. She knows where the money's hidden. And ultimately, that's what it's all about.
You talk about the challenges. Of course, it's been an interesting couple of years for investors and shareholders, but you reckon reasons now to be confident and optimistic? You've got a firm hand on the steering wheel going forward?
Firmish. We've declared a half-year profit. We've said to our shareholders that, so earlier in the year, we said to our shareholders that we expected to reach profitability by Q4 2018. So we're a little bit ahead on that, which we're, you know, incredibly happy about. But it's all about sustaining that profit. It's a, you know, it is a challenging market. It's a highly fragmented marketplace, and it's very competitive in the UK. But we believe that by using our cash reserves to invest in those areas of business where we're very, very strong, have a very strong offering, you know, having really considered the marketplace and looking at where the competition is and looking at where our skills and relationships are, you know, we believe we can take the company to profit and onwards and upwards from there.
Great to see you, Claire. Thanks for your time.
Thank you very much, Andrew.